Good afternoon, Kiev. Добрый день. Hi. Thank you. Okay, so first I want to clarify the off topic for Scala, but microservices, but it will be fine. You have a Twitter, you can tweet me, and I will be around if you have more questions afterwards. And the idea of this talk is to let you know what is the criteria for you to decompose your monoliths to microservices. Okay, so let's start. So myself is Phil. I've been working in the industry for the past 17 years in many positions, in many variety of jobs. In the past 6 years, I joined Wix. And in this time, we moved to Scala and to microservices, and I will talk about it in this talk. Okay, so do you know Wix? Who knows Wix? Okay. For those who don't know, Wix originally is a website builder, mainly for non-tech guys, people, your grandmother, to build a website easily with a WYSIWYG. This is our editor. But in the past 2 years, we increased our product to have, make your own presence on the web, not only websites, but also more tools. Well, why it's important? Because we do it with microservices, and we'll talk about it. So some numbers, just to get the idea of what we're talking about. We have many services, so we have 72 million users, which are actually building websites. We have 2 petabytes of data, of media files, video, images, and so on. We have 3 data centers on-premise, and we have all major clouds running. We serve 2 billion requests a day. And we are more than 100 people working in Wix. Our R&D is in a 4 locations, Tel Aviv, the original one, Dnipropetrovsk in Ukraine, Vilnius, and we're just now opening an office in Kiev, which is very excited for us. We love Ukraine and we want to be here. Our main stack is Scala, and on the client side we have Angular, on the server, and we are a TDD shop. We believe in TDD. Okay, so about 5 years ago, we had a dinosaur monolith server which we suffer from it. We couldn't deploy. Every version would take 2 months. It was very painful. We had bugs. We deployed. We rolled back. Everything was manual, and we suffered. And in fact, let's say 5 years, and it's still going on. We now become a microservice architecture. We have 2 other services. We are fully continuous delivery. We change the production 100 times a day. And I'm going to talk about it, this talk. Just to get a very 20 miles view from the air, what is the services that we're working on? It's a partial list, and it's still growing as we speak. Okay? So, microservices is the new black. It's trending. Everyone talk about it. I want to tell you, a month ago, we ran with my colleague Tomer, which is speaking tomorrow. We were running a Java IELCO meetup, and we talk about microservices because it's important, people love it, people talk about it, and people also misuse it. And I want to today to show you how to do it in a good way. Okay, so I took it from Wikipedia, you can read it yourself, but I don't want to, just want to clarify that microservices does not necessarily small. People think that microservices are, I have a nano service, like I have a class, can be service. No. You can have a big service, and it will still be a microservice. You decompose your monolith by different criteria, and not by if it's going to be small or not. And all these buzzwords around about microservices, which I'm not going to talk about today, but I'll be around. If you have questions, you can contact me, maybe Twitter or even here or whatever. I'm going to talk about when you should decompose your monolith, because I think it's the most important thing you should know, because people make mistakes and misuse microservices. But you know why you need to know when because sometimes less is more. You don't need it. And you know what? Microservices has a trade-off. Like any other good thing that we do, microservices give us trade-off, and let's go over them. When you go out to AIO, you go into uncertainty mode. You don't know what's going on. When you do a code within your CPU, you are in the deterministic way. You know the if, the else, you know how your code going on. But now you live in a multi-IO environment with many services. You live in uncertainty. You don't know what's going on. The DNS can be down. The UPS can break your power. Many things can be done when you go out on the network. And it's a very uncertain environment. You don't know what to do. It's a problem. Partner deployment. Now you have 100 services in production, and you want to develop a new feature. But this new feature should be touched few services. So now it's problematic. In the old way, when you have a monolith, you deploy the server. But now you deploy partial of the feature from each server, and it's a problem. It's different mindset. Ops complexity. In the back days, when you have monolith, you just know you have a bash script, you install your server easily. It was easy. Everyone knows how to install your server. Now you have hundreds of services. You have ops complexity. You need to know how to do it. It's very complex. It's not like learning one thing and it keeps growing and you're adding more and more services. And you have service discovery and so on. So it's complex. How to refactor? If you want to refactor your code in a monolith, you go to your IDE, IntelliJ, Eclipse, whatever you do, refactor, you change the interface easily. But now you have interface between services, which gets IO, we have different deployment phase, and want to refactor them, it's a problem. And end-to-end is challenging. In a monolith, you just run the server and do your end-to-end test. Run server and database. But now we have 100 services. How you do end-to-end? It's a complex thing and it's different. Okay. But each of these has some integration. Let's go over them. The IO hop. So you should learn and you can learn how to configure your HTTP client. You can choose either Apache. Then you can say I want to move to something asynchronous like a Ning async HTTP. Or you want to have Spray client. And then you know how to configure your HTTP connection pool. And how to do your DNS resolving. And do many things. You know something? The connection pool of database, C3PO, is being built for years. And every time it keeps advanced. Also HTTP. You can do some modification to your client to have more certainty. To know what you do when you go out of the IO. You can do retry. You do request to one server, you can do retry. It's easy. You can do retry policy, you can do one retry. You know that one retry will solve 90% of your problem. In general, two retry, one retry will be enough. But you can do retry policy, you can do exponential delay. I want to retry one, and I want to retry in a second, and in 5 seconds, and 10 seconds. I can be more reliable. But if you do retry, you want to be idempotent. You know everyone knows idempotent API? So idempotence, okay. Idempotence is about have single side effects. So you want to, if you do many retries, so you do only one side, for example, you have transaction, you do billing, you don't want the customer to be charged twice. So you do idempotent API when you can. You can do circuit breaker. So the clients are non-biasing. So you can choose and you can do be more tolerant for failure, and you want to know that the server has bad quality of service, and you can choose whatever you do. You can do monitoring. And most importantly, you can, in some cases, when the API can is a virtual consistent, you can be virtual consistent. So you can have sort of a message bus, ActiveMQ, or whatever, or any Kafka to have a virtual consistent API. So you can do many things to resolve the IO. Partial deployment, it's easy. You have feature token or feature switches in your system. You deploy the versions in multiple servers. The feature is off, and then you operate gradually. So it's easy. You can do it. Ops complexity. In the back day, in the monolith, it was one server, it's easy to deploy, but now we change the mindset, it's a cultural change. The developers are the DevOps. They need to load the server, they need to load to deploy it. So everyone, every developer is now is the architect, is you don't actually write this code that the script that installs the server. But you need to know how the server looks like and deploy it. And also automation. Everything should be automated. Everything that you do manually, it's not good. You should be automate everything. I'm not going to talk about testing now. If we have time, you can ask questions and then I'm going to talk about it because it's complex. Strong interface, how to refactor. So now we need to think more. How to be backward compatible. How to add new parameters, new API. How your JSON serialization will be agnostic for a new parameter which does not exist. So you need to think of it. Once you think of it, you can do it. And you can do a proper contact test. So in your build time, when you check, you do commit, and one other service needs you, if you have proper contact test, when you change the interface, and your build system supports it, it can be break on build time, which is important. But if you do all these mitigations and everything, you need to remember, once you add service, you add final point. There is no magic. Adding services, adding final point, this is equal. Okay, but I told you that we move to microservices. And it's doing good for us, and we're happy. And you have final point, but I tell you something. We should do it. And I want to know, tell you now, what are the criteria to decompose your monolith? It's important. So let's go over four use cases which with their respective solutions. The first use case is decompose. When different SLA things share their same resources. So let's have the use case. I have a server which is an e-commerce server with a catalog. So I have a catalog and it's an online shop. And I have items and I have price and I have t-shirts and size and colors. And I can manage inventory. And I have pricing and I have a lot of things. The server does two things. One thing, it does this CRUD operation for the items. Adding, deleting, change pricing and so on. The second API is uploading a file. I want to see the I'm an online shop for t-shirts. I want to see it. So I have this API for upload file. And the CRUD items go to database and the files go to file storage. So I have one server that does two things. But let's say we have a problem in network for the file storage. What's happening now? Several threads are busy on I/O. Server cannot accept one request. Client cannot do request. So, what we see here? We see that because of non-critical feature like upload the file, I cannot do critical mission like changing the price or I want to remove inventory, I want to remove item. Okay, I have a vendor give me my t-shirts. I cannot get more t-shirts from him. I want to remove the inventory. Now I have downtime. Because no one can upload files, I cannot update this critical step. So it's complex. And let's talk about SLA. Okay, so SLA originally came from the world of telco. How time I will cover my downtime and so on. But SLA, we also use it in our business. It's a service-level agreement. It means how much, it has many answers, many questions. How consistent I want to be, how available. Let's say I want to get a response for 20 milliseconds. Sometimes 1 second is enough. Sometimes I say, I don't care. You can give a response within an hour, but it must be reliable and consistent. You can have many things. I want to tell you some story. I used to work in a telco in the industry and we developed a service for the phones. So every time someone calls you, you hear music. So if the server don't respond within, let's say 5 milliseconds, there's someone that calls you have quiet. So it's very complex. So the answer there was, I don't, if you find what to play, do it. If you don't, return default tune. It's important to know the SLA. SLA is defined by a product manager, not by, we are engineer, we are coding. We should ask the product manager, what is the SLA we need to do? And SLA is important. So every time you do, and I want to now go over the solution. So, you decompose. We have two services now. One service is more high available, which is the CRUD API. The second one is the file upload. The file can get information from the item if it needs, and it saves it. So everything is okay. So this is the first use case, and this is the most canonical use case. You need to know what is the SLA of your features, and divide them, divide your services according to them. Okay. So, different life cycle. Each feature has different life cycle. What are the things? Okay. So I have the same service. Another service has another feature about coupons. I want to create coupons for Christmas, for Father's Day, for Mother's Day, whatever, any day. And these coupon features are changing frequently. Every time I change my coupon and so on. So, there is a few guys working on the coupon and some guys working on the items and improving the service. So, on 4 p.m., I deploy a service because I need to fix some of the CRUD operation. At 5 p.m., I deploy a coupon feature because I have changes for Christmas or so on. I run the coupon changes because I have more prizes and more things to my customers. At 9 p.m., I deploy another coupon feature. At 12 a.m., I roll back the service because I had a bug on the CRUD, on the feature of the catalog. So what's happening? When I roll back this service, which has both coupons and the CRUD for the catalog, I lose all the coupon functionality. So I have different life cycle. These coupons change frequently, and if I roll back the service because of this, I go to previous version, until this point, I'm losing all functionality, and the company loses money. So we need to think, every time we have features which have different life cycle of deployment, decompose them to different services. So solution is trivial, I have another coupon service, I have team work on it, it's deployed independently, and I have the catalog service, which is the same catalog service. The third thing, reuse and share logic. From university and from every time we start writing code, all we did, we learn, do not repeat yourself. Decompose. Have function. Don't repeat yourself. So this is also good for microservices. Let's take a look at the catalog service again. Now, these guys want to resolve the game of the user. The city, the country, the map information, and so on. So this game of functionality does three things. It goes to Google, it gets the latitude and from the maps. It goes to a third party, and by given IP, it gives them the city and the country. And it also has some database information with cache and so on. Everything going good. I have this GEO, I run it in my server, so catalog also knows GEO. I can give different price for different location. I want to give, for example, in Dnipropetrovsk, different price, and different price in Kiev, different price in Lviv. Everything is good. Now, this server also needs the GEO. So, the solution will be easy. Let's decompose a third service of the GEO. The user server and the item catalog are calling the GEO service. Everything is fine. But why I'm showing this to you? Because people make mistakes. People say, I have my logic here. Okay. I don't want another service. I can do some, I can make a jar of it, an API. And I use this jar here. So now two different services share the same logic of the jar. This jar talks to Google, GEO, and the database. And now let's say that we have 20 services that are using this jar. First of all, we break the rule. Microservices talk to each other by their interface. Now let them talk by database, which is not good. Second of thing, let's say Google now is down, and I have 20 services in production, which using the GAO, and Google is down. Now I get alerts and 20 services. It's hard to maintain. And the biggest rule for microservices is that each service must have its own DB. In some cases, you can have second service that reads, but you don't want to write for two services to take the DB. The DB is like the holy temple for the service. It's important. I want to go over an example which you shouldn't decompose on it. Let's say you have a service A and service B. Both of them sharing logic of decryption of a cookie. So it has the same logic. Shouldn't we have a microservice? No, we shouldn't. You don't want to pay with an I/O of something that is CPU bound. You want to decompose a service and a real logic with something that costly with op, with DevOps and so on. And something CPU bound is deterministic and very consistent and secure. The last thing I want to talk about, and it's most important for me, it's the single tip of responsibility. And let's talk about it. Do you know that 90% of projects are failed? They fail by content, by bugs, or by markets. We never on time. I never see a project that is done on time. We are delayed. It's in its nature. That's what we do. Do you know how to make it 70%? Anyone knows? Any idea? How to fail 70% of time, not 90%? Do you know? No idea? Okay, I'm going to tell you. Small teams and small project periods. If you make 3 to 5 developers per team, you will be failing only 70% of the projects beyond time. It's an article, right? And you should decompose to support operational scalability. You need to have small team, then you decompose operation. So each team has its own microservice. And also, large team cannot handle efficiently large code base. It won't. If you have small teams and small code base, it will be more manageable, more efficient way. And also accountability. If I am in a small team, I'll be more accountable. Let's say, for example, I'm in charge of the Go service. It's my domain. I know this. I love it. If I'm part of 100 developers that does everything, I'm like a tiny thing. And a small team encourage you to have accountable. And I cannot skip corners though. You know corners though? Corners though think about that your output of engineering will be similar to your organization structure. So if you have 4 teams, you may have 4 systems. And what my idea for it? We should engineer our organization structure. And by that, we have better architecture. So we have small team and small microservices. And this is, I want to take from you. You want to be a corporate in a size, but you want to feel startup. In weeks, our guys feel like a startup. We have every small teams, every responsibility. And I want to talk about in a bit about Wix leads and gangs. So Wix move to something like Spotify, where leads and gangs. So the gangs are like small companies. That's a company I'm doing in Wix, the hotel solution, I'm doing the restaurants, I'm doing the e-commerce. Each small team has its own microservices, self microservices. And the guild is like the affiliation of the professional things. So we couldn't do this without microservices. So we're very happy with it. So microservices help us also And HR is important. So let's make a short summary of what I talk. The first thing, resource allocation. You have running on multiple resources, compete on them with things with different SLA, so we decompose. The second thing is life cycle. You have something change frequently, decompose, have it separately. Share logic, use logic. You have logic of service, like a deal or something, the bio, put it aside, call it with the interface. And the most important thing is small team is important. You want to have a startup-ish culture, not like corporate-ish culture, not to be big, you want to grow. But when you have small teams, the things like feel like startup, they feel accountable, they feel like they and the customer, the employees are happy. They're very happy. Okay. So now my last part of my talk is about you want to start from something, so we do it with caution. I'll give you some few tips on how you start with microservices. Okay, so first thing mentioned is gradually. You live in an environment of monolith. Everyone, let's say, not very happy, but they're used to it. Now you come to your manager and you say, okay, I want to have a microservice. You don't know, you don't feel, and you don't want to, you want to do it gradually. So let's take, for example, again, the GEO service. So I will do a GEO service, but I will keep, in the beginning, my code inside my catalog, and I transfer gradually the traffic, so I'll be confident. It's important. Two things gradually. You need to learn, because every time you do ops, you get new DevOps, you have more problems. Second thing, if you don't want to lose your job, don't start from the most critical service. Take something not important. For example, if you have the catalog service of the e-commerce, the shop online, let's take something that suggests two different items. So I bought a t-shirt, it suggests me pants. If this would be failing, of course we lose money, but people will still able to buy. So choose things very important for a company. Start with them. Confidence. Going microservices is lose confidence in the beginning. So you lose confidence, not only you, but your managers, your peers, your product guys, your marketing guys, everyone lose confidence. You should. It means slowly. You should talk about things. You added your service outside, talk about it. Talk about it in emails. People should be used to the terms of what you're doing. Confidence should be slowly. I showed you the balloon in the beginning. So there's many things you can do with circuit breaker and many things. But there's something you should not give up. You must start with them. So monitoring. In microservices, when a request comes, in the case that the request goes in 20 services, 20 hops, you shouldn't give up for monitoring, it's the most important thing. Monitoring from day one. Okay. Talking. Okay, I want to say something. Failure equals learning. Every time you fail, you learn. It's important. You should fail. You want to fail. And you should do something we call post-mortem. Every time we fail, we have downtime. We gather in the room, everyone, we sit, we talk. We talk about problem. But we talk about problem and get the conclusion. Not only forgetting conclusion. When we sit and talk, the people that are in the room are learning. You're going to a new system, a new microservices. You want to talk and learn. So you must fail. It's important. Yeah, no, I'll tell you something. In weeks, when we started with a lot of days of downtimes, and it was crazy, and we rolled back every day, and it was crazy, and the chaos. But now, when you do all this learning of the failure, we are so happy with it. And it goes easy for us. And it's so good. So talking, and not like blaming, you know? People feel the blame. Don't be blame. You should be happy to talk that, okay, I did data corruption. I did this. It's okay. Talk. It's not, yeah, it's funny, I know, but yeah, in weeks, people are not afraid because it's not blaming. It's important to talk and talk to more many people and share it with your company. Yes, it's important to learn and to take conclusion. And for example, you have something that failed. Okay, I need to do this for next time, change the mechanism. But talk and learn. And fail. Fail equal learn. There is no place, company in the world that moves to microservices or to any new thing without failing. And by failing and talking, people learn things. So, start for something. You should start for something. I don't know. You should start for the most little thing. Once you're happy, continue. Okay, questions. I will be happy to have questions if you have. Yes, please.
When you look to the microservice architecture, how do you approach the database decomposition? Because the question I'm asking is really when you have a monolith, the database is usually very coupled.
Yes.
So you can't just pick a part and move it to another database.
I agree. Okay, so the question was when we move microservices, we have coupled database together. So the pattern we like, it's a multi-write. So I have new service, and in some phase I write twice, so the old monolith service and the new database. And when I'm reading, I try to read from the new one. If I fail, I go to the other one. So in every time we have new service and new migration for database, we do multi-read and try to wait for one, then write to the other one, and then do it gradually. And then something, we don't even do database migration. Everything done lazily. So when a request comes, no data, I will do regression for this request, and this is how we do it. That's your question? Thank you. Good one. Yes, please.
Could you split your microservice because of team, for example, 7? Exceed level 5 developers.
Okay.
Seven.
Okay, so the question was if we have 7 people, do you split? We believe in up to 6 guys. And there is difference between rules and guidelines, okay? This is the guideline, not the rule. If it's going for your P7, stick with it. If you don't have good team leader to split, stick with it. But you want small teams, so people feel more owner and feel they are owner of something. So it's a guideline, not a rule. So whenever you feel comfortable, this is my answer. I'm a pragmatic developer and I believe in guidelines and liberal and everything. Yes, please. More questions, please. Yes, please.
So when you extract the microservice, you probably like do it maybe how do you make sure it's ready to serve production? Like, does it have all the weird parts of APIs?
Can you open the question? Sorry.
Do you like play basically production traffic onto the microservice along with traffic to the?
Okay. We don't replay the traffic. I think Twitter does it. What we do when we have new microservice or new feature, using feature token or A/B test mechanism, we can save part of the traffic. So for example, in the beginning we say, I want all Greek employees to get this traffic. Then I go Israel and Ukraine. Then I go Lithuania. And I feel comfortable with getting more geo in countries gradually. So I start with small, few employees. This is how we work, it's completely different. Sounds like a question?
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, please.
How do you manage feature backlog for those small teams? Because I was playing the question a little bit because I guess your business owners, they don't think on the level of microservices, they think on the level of business features, right? So, but then you need to split one big business feature into small changes for each of the microservices. Do they go into separate backlogs and so on? How do you synchronize the things?
So basically, the teams are divided by by their domain. So e-commerce guy have the e-commerce services. So when they have new features, let's say they have five services, the catalog, the cashier for checkout, the inventory and so on. So with that new feature, it's a 3-4 guys, they know the features and then they know how to match. But if it's between company, so as I said before, if it's feature that goes between few teams, every feature has a feature token, switch to switch. So we deploy the version, and a product guy can open them gradually. So you can deploy it, and there's one guy that opens the switch. So we deploy everything. Okay. Cool. More questions, please. Yes?
What technologies is it built on? Platforms.
Okay, so in Wix. Okay, so originally we were a Java shop with Spring. And we moved to Scala in the past 5 years. So everything now is Scala, a framework is Scala. Between services, we talk with JSON RPC, no? JSON RPC? Okay, JSON RPC is like a JSON with a schema of a method and parameters. So, but how we did it? If you think JSON RPC is like an RPC of a JSON, so we made an abstraction layer so you can create a thread of Scala or instance of Java with functions. So as a developer, I implement a thread or I call in a function, but in below, we serialize this function and the thread into JSON schema. So between servers, we have a compatibility. We can depend on the JVM, on the POM XML dependency, but below, we do a JSON. So it's easy for us to talk like we call it a function, but below it's JSON RPC. It's answer the question? And I want to say that we are a fully TDD, so we believe in test first, and clean code, so we have no fear. So everyone goes and we can move, people can move between teams, people can change things easily, and living in a world of continuous delivery, we change the production 20,000 times a year. It's crazy. We deploy, my guy is deploying in the middle of the night, in 4 a.m., in 3 a.m., we don't care. In Saturday, in Sunday, we don't care. So we feel TDD. So we have TDD and Scala. In database, we have mostly MySQL. So we know how to do it very good, but we have many other things. We have Cassandra, and we have Redis, and Elasticsearch, and many other things. And but our infrastructure is like, in general, MySQL, Scala, Spring. We still have Spring. We don't like it. I don't like dependency injection because it gives you a lot of magic, but it's a different topic, a different talk. But this is the stack we use. Is it answer the question? Yes. Thank you. One question, please.
So, for GCs, you need a lot of unit tests.
Yes. So as we do the TTD, we're starting for a failing test. So I'm starting for an end-to-end test. Tomorrow I have a talk here about how we write feature in Wix. We do live coding. I'm starting from the test from outside. So we start from the test, and everything is tested. You don't try even single line of code without a failing test. So we have 100,000 of tests running. Unit test, integration test, end-to-end test, acceptance tests, and it's how it works.
It's classic TDD.
TDD, yes. Please, more questions. Yes, please.
What do you think about Lagom?
About what?
Lagom.
Ah, Lagom, okay. 5 minutes, okay. Okay, I look at Lagom. Okay, first of all, we do look at new infrastructure. We look now at ACA. And ACA persistent, and we do also CQRS. We look, okay, and Lagom, good question. Lagom, first of all, is new. Lagom is the new local services by Lightband, which use Jersey for binding, and it's used in below. The interfaces are like ACA, an ACA stream. But as a developer, the semantics is classes and interfaces. We're going to have a pilot within a couple of months of both Lagom, the Lightband, and ACA, because we really want to move towards CQRS and event sourcing. Because we already have 5 projects with 2 CQRS. Our e-com will develop a new query network trust with all CQRS and event sourcing, which we very like it. So Lacom is a good question. I know it's not mature enough, but we do want to look at it and test it. Also, Lacom is built by design for event sourcing. So Jonathan Bonner says, there is no such thing of delete and update database. You do only insert, that's it. So this is the idea of about behind it. It's very nice. Yes, please. We have 2 more minutes or more questions, and I'll be around, so... Okay, one more last question, and we'll finish. Yes, please.
Did you manage to have the hybrid architecture? I mean, microservice is distributed computing?
About what, can you repeat the question?
So do you have something like Akka versus microservices?
Akka versus microservices. You can build Akka on microservices if you want.
Yeah.
Is Akka remoting?
So it's actually distributed computing and microservices.
I'm not sure about the question.
Okay.
Sorry, take it offline? Okay. Okay, so, let's second. Okay, we are arriving and we love Ukraine and we're going to have an office in Kiev. So, if you know any good friends that want to work with us, look at Engage Technologies, please talk to me. And thank you, it was awesome. Thank you.